Hello, New York Comic Con! Thank you so much for coming to this special Seis Manos panel, or as I like to call it, the Seis Manos panels. My name is E. Ryan Brown. I am a marketing guy. I do not actually have that bod. nowhere close. This is about Seis Manos, which means six hands, but you probably already all knew that. And let's just bring out the guests. First guest, co-creator and writer Alvaro Rodriguez. Sir, will you please come up to the stage? Come on down. You gotta do like the, I won, yay, I'm gonna do the Price is Right. You can sit close to me if you'd like to. And why don't you tell them about yourself a little bit?
Okay. I am the co-creator and executive producer of the show that I'm really, really proud of, Seis Manos, with Viz Media and Netflix. And it's amazing to be here in New York with you guys. I worked a lot with my cousin Robert Rodriguez. I wrote Machete with him and a movie called Shorts and a lot of other stuff from Dusk Till Dawn, the series. And so he's definitely a big influence on my career and my work, and definitely a big inspiration for Seis Manos.
And you can feel it. When you see it, you'll sort of see sort of shades of those different things in here. All right, please put your hands together for Angelica Vell Garcia, or Angelica Valle. Come on up here, pretty lady. She has been working her buns off, flying all over the world, talking about their show, and I bet you want to tell them what the story is about again.
Hi, how are you? I love the Angelica Vale thing. Love it. Yeah, my name is more like Angelica Valle.
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. So many Latinos in the house. Yes, I love it. Yeah. Latino power. And I come from the telenovela world, theater world. Yeah. Oh, they like it too. I didn't know how close these worlds are, telenovela and anime, because you love drama, guys. And we Latinos, we know drama. We know about drama.
Okay, and last but not least, let's bring up super handsome Johnny Cruz. Voice of Jesus.
What's up?
Oh, did you want to?
What do you want me to do?
Oh, just say what's up.
What's up, guys? Thank you guys for coming out. We got some Overwatchers. Great.
Perfect. Nailed it. Okay, we're going to ask them a couple questions before we show you the premiere, just so we can sort of see what this is all about before we dive in. First question, Alvaro. Tell us the story of Seis Manos. How did this all come to be?
Well, okay, so Seis Manos is sort of the brainchild of Brad Graber from Powerhouse Animation that also does Castlevania. And just got announced they're doing the reboot of Masters of the Universe with Kevin Smith. And so Seis Manos was a concept that Brad had had for a long time that was kind of stewing in his brain. They were trying to figure out the story. And I came on board a few years back and really tried to flesh out the story and create a world and really dig into the characters and what this thing could be. And it was a little bit of a kind of like Brad and I doing a duet of my favorite things and bringing in Kung Fu and Mexican culture and Mexican cinema and mysticism and all kinds of stuff in this soup that became Escalda, that became Seis Manos. And, we partnered up with Viz Media and then took the project to Netflix after going through a process of different people who either loved the show or loved the idea of the show but didn't know who the audience would be for it, and therefore were afraid to do it. Or we met with people who said, that's not anime. Anime is Japanese. I said, well, this is Mexicanime. And so, since then, it's been an amazing process of, writing the scripts with Daniel Dominguez, my writing partner on the project, who came from animation. This is my first animated project. And Daniel had worked on shows like SpongeBob and Captain Underpants and stuff, so a little bit different from Seis Manos. And then casting it and getting to work with great people like Johnny and Angelica and Aislinn Derbez and Vic Chow and Danny Trejo, who I've worked with many times, it's just been like a dream come true.
That is a good origin story, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, for Angelica, Seis Manos has finally been released upon the world through Netflix. Are you excited to finally share your work?
Of course. Are you kidding? My first time in English. I was so excited because I never thought my first work in English was going to be a voiceover with this weird accent that I have. So I'm really happy, and I'm really happy about the reaction of the fans. And I'm really happy that now my fans are like growing because I'm discovering all this new world of anime, and it's amazing. I just love it, and the response has been amazing, so I'm super happy. And finally, we have a Mexican anime. The Latinos, we are there. I'm sorry, I have to say that, but I grew up without watching myself there, you know? So finally, I mean, my kids won't see the show in a couple of years, but but when they see it, they finally gonna recognize themselves there. And that's very important to me.
That is important. Okay, for Johnny, is it true you had to put on over 200 cartoon pounds to play this role?
Easiest thing I ever did. I mean, Jesus is a really fun character for me because I really love to be someone who adds kind of comedic moments in some of the most dramatic times, you know, during something. I think comedy is so needed, and Jesus brings a lovely piece of it, and me being able to bring that in this Seis Manos has been kind of what I like to do. So you guys cast the right guy.
Okay, this is for the whole group. The Latin community is a massive part of the American population, but sorely underrepresented in the media, especially in comics, fantasy, and animation. Does it make you proud to work on a show that's helping to change that?
Absolutely. I mean, it's the DNA of the show, you know? That's the whole reason for being. It was this idea of, like, representation matters, you know? And being able to see brown characters animated in this style and in this kind of thing that I think, you know, is still kind of a new frontier, and there's more opportunities now to tell these kinds of stories, to do these kinds of things, and not worry about will it find an audience, because we know that it will, and we know that it has. And so, yeah, I'm absolutely proud to be a small part of that.
And the combination of cultures, the Chinese, you know, culture with the Mexican culture is so cool. It looks so cool. I mean, there's a scene in the second episode. I don't want to, you know, say anything.
Spoil it.
No, no, of course not. But it's beautiful because it's a song. They have a song with a Mexican. Is Mexican? She Mexican? Thank you. With a Latina singing in Spanish. And they have this super amazing kung fu fight. Oh, my gosh. Amazing thing. I love that part of the show. Watch it. You're gonna love it. It's amazing. I simply love it.
I mean, to be, for me, growing up and not seeing myself represented as a hero, you know, that was something I never really got to see. So to see Brown, and for them not to be a drug dealer, for them not to be, you know, a terrorist or whatever, to be the hero, I think to me is something that has been a dream, right? And to see more of that is what I would like to see more of.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I'm into that. All right, for Angelica, your character Garcia is a tough cop that don't take guff. Did you do any research for this part, like talk tough cops that don't take guff?
Of course. You can tell I have all the attitude of a tough girl. No. Sadly, no. I'm very good citizen, so I didn't want to get in trouble. No, I'm kidding. With any cops? No. Of course, you have to believe in the creators and the directors, because of course you go into the studio and you don't see anything what you guys are going to see now, what you're going to watch now. You just have your character. They have your character, and they say, here's your character. Now, here's the script. Go crazy. And sometimes I was reading, and I was like, oh, so the head, wait, what? The head rolls? Oh, okay, so what, blood? Oh, perfect. Oh, wait, what? And sometimes I was so confused because I didn't know what they were talking about, really. I was like, okay, guys, so I don't know about this next line. Please help me a little bit. And you have to really be confident on them. But I knew that I was protected. I knew that I was with the best people in the business, and I felt super comfortable. So I did it with no preparation. Car preparation, though.
That's one of the fun things about the process is that we get to create the character with you when we're doing that, you know? Like she said, when she walks into the recording booth, there's no animation. There might be a character design and something like that, and you've got to figure out, okay, now how would this, what am I going to do? It's all in your imagination. And so just that process of working with Angelica was amazing, to find Garcia and all of that.
All right, next question. I personally feel like Seis Manos has a dose of From Dusk Till Dawn, a scoop of the 70s Kung Fu TV show, a bit of Shaft, and they were sprinkled all over with delicious John Carpenter flakes and baked in the hot Mexican sun. Is that accurate?
Yes. You know, I've described the show as like Machete meets Kill Bill on the set of Coco. Yeah, I mean, you'll see if you watch the entirety of the series, there's a lot of nods to all of these things, like I said, that we loved. John Carpenter movies and Kung Fu movies, Kung Fu theater shows that, you know, we grew up watching on TV. And all of these kinds of elements are definitely, this is a love letter to all of those things, I think.
And you can really feel it when you see it. Also, the show does not hold back. Crazy kung fu fights, buckets of blood, supernatural spooky stuff, and about a million bullets. What was it like working on something this wild?
I've told this story before, but usually when I first was told that they wanted me for the role, I kind of didn't really know what it was about. And anytime it's, you know, ethnically charged in any way, I'm very hesitant. But they asked me to read the scripts. And so when I read the scripts, it was literally like from page one, I was like, okay, let's see what this is about. Let's see the stereotypes they're going to put in here. Mm-hmm. Oh my God. What's going to happen? Oh my God. What? And like, I went through the whole series like in a matter of like 2 hours. And I was like, that is the craziest thing I've ever read. And it had so like many different parts of different cultures that I love that they were smashing together from Mexico to Chinese culture to Eastern philosophy, and the amalgamation became this thing in my brain that was like, they made it all work. It was just something really I had never seen before. And so that's when I was like, I'll do it.
Okay.
Well, yeah. Well, he said it all. he said it all. Kind of all. Well, for me, it was a completely different process because, yes. Because I hate castings. Because in my world, in the Latino world, we don't do castings. That, like, they know me since I was a baby. And they already know what they're going to get with me. So so I'm really bad at castings. I hate them. So I remember my manager calling me saying, hey, please, Angelica, send your casting. Really? I mean, it's just a voice. Just record it on your phone and send it. And I was like, really, I have to? So I sent it, I think, the last day of the process that I could send it, I sent it. And then a couple of days later, I was in Mexico doing a novela, actually, and they called me and say, hey, you have a callback. And I was like, wait, what? You have a callback? Oh, really? Okay, but I'm not in LA, I'm in Mexico. Oh, when are you coming back? Oh, I don't know, this week. They say, perfect, that's a callback week. You're going to be in LA. And I was like, oh, perfect. So I got there. I was really shaking like crazy. I saw Alvaro, I remember you, looking at me. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm going to die here. This is going to be painful and horrible. For me, it was. And I was reading there, and suddenly my Mexican tongue went like, a la. I was like, I'm so sorry, can I start again? And they were super nice. Yes, no worries. Okay, go ahead. I went out of there and told my mom, I didn't get it for sure. I'm not getting this because I was horrible in there. I don't know what happened to you guys. It was a miracle. But 2 weeks later, they called me and said, you got it. And it was one of the happiest days of my life because I swear I was so happy. And I read the scripts and I just, the same thing happened to me. It was so many good things put together in the same show. And I was part of it. And they gave me the opportunity to do it in Spanish. So I did the English version and the Spanish version. And now I'm learning Chinese, Portuguese. I'm kidding. No, of course not. But but I'm really happy. And I cannot be more proud of this series.
You got to get your Rosetta Stone going.
Thank you. Yes, I will.
Okay, almost done with the questions here. Johnny, you voice Lucio from Overwatch, who's also a larger-than-life party guy. Why do you think you keep getting these roles? Do you just have that vibe?
No, I'm very serious every day of my life. I like deep talks. And no, I actually do like deep talks. But, I think I don't know. I guess there's a truth. I think the closest you get to sincerity sometimes is a big part of yourself, right? And I think I learned that from Lucio. Was like, that's a role that was very close to me in a way. Like, it was like I wasn't putting on too much of a voice, but this was me, like, probably when I'm all charged up is my Lucio. And I would say when I got Overwatch, it was probably the easiest job I ever booked. Because I did the least amount of, like, work and prep. I was just like, ha, look, I'm all hyped up. And then I just went in there. with Jesus, it's interesting because I think he's kind of a bit of that, but he's a little bit more emotional in this series. He's a lot more, wears his heart on his sleeve a lot and just wants people to get along and be happy, kind of like Lucio, but also has a drinking problem. I think they both have something that I always want to put in my work is some heart. You know, they both have heart, and this whole series, when you watch it, there's a lot of heart to this series. While all this weird stuff's going on, there's something that draws you in, and I think it is that little of just sincerity you guys have in it. So yeah,
the drinking problem was my idea.
All right, final question, then we will get to the preview. For the group, probably you the most, the martial arts scenes are very intricate. What is the secret to making a compelling fight scene?
Wow, I think there's probably at least two secrets to making a compelling fight scene. One is that on a purely technical level, we worked with an amazing martial artist, Sifu Thomas Leverett in Austin, Texas, who helped choreograph all of the fight sequences. And so the artists from the animation studio got to work with a real martial artist, a real expert, to get all of the elements as close to absolutely correct as possible. So it's a very authentic feel in that way. And then on my side, because I'm not a kung fu artist, on my side, the secret to making a good fight sequence is that it means something in the story. You know, it's not just, well, they fight. You know, just to do it, but it actually is connected to what's happening in the story, and even more to the characters themselves and how the characters, like, because Jesus has a drinking problem and he does the drunken boxing style of things, that reveals so much about his character and the way he fights. You know, and Isabella and Silencio too, and the styles that they do is really kind of indicative of their personalities. And so finding those elements, and when you're writing the scripts and developing that stuff, I think it makes the fight sequences feel that much more, I don't know, potent, powerful, and meaningful.
You definitely need a reason to fight.
Yes.
Okay, we are gonna show the episode right now, the first episode, but like I said before, it's quite violent. Oh, thank you. Woo! All right, would you please put your hands together for our wonderfully talented guests? And we are gonna do an audience Q&A, so hopefully there's a mic somewhere. Room, guys, do we have a mic? Where's the mic? Okay, cool. So line up over there if you want to ask questions. Please keep them classy. Let's be nice. And also, there is a signing for this cast later today. The tickets are all gone, but if you want to come and try your luck as sort of like the overflow, there is definitely a chance, I would say. And that is at 2:30, Seis Manos signing 1E04. So if you want to get an autograph from these wonderful people, come there and see if you can get in the overflow. My first question before the audience asks you guys questions. That was pretty intense. Is that kid going to be okay? Jesus, dude.
Pobre Domingo. No. No. Not. Okay. It would have been 8 manos, and now it's...
No.
If you notice, he's wearing the jersey with the number 8.
See? Cool. You already beat me to it.
Yeah.
That was smart.
Okay, first question from the audience.
I mean, yep. I got it. How you guys doing? How you guys doing?
Good, good.
All right, so I got... First off, I got to point out... When you're doing the show and everything like that, props to using the grindhouse stuff and everything. Mm-hmm. I saw those scripts and everything like that and everything. I love grindhouse films, so the fact that you homage that, you know, outstanding. Thank you so much.
Woo!
So my question to you guys is, since you do watch a lot of films based on grindhouse and all influenced by that stuff, what's your favorite grindhouse film? Like, all of you guys, I gotta know. You gotta let me know.
Well, I mean, I love grindhouse movies. I wrote on the Planet Terror from Grindhouse,
yeah.
And you know, just been a fan of that stuff since I was a kid. And you know, some of the grindhouse stuff is kung fu stuff. Some of it is, you know, schlocky sci-fi or horror and all of that stuff. And all of that was blaxploitation movies like Truck Turner and Shaft and things like that. All of this stuff was part of our, you know. The palette that we were painting from, you know. So we definitely wanted to talk, you know, to show that visually, to make references to that kind of cinema. It's, I think, you know, there's some. It was popular entertainment that sometimes had the ability to smuggle in some serious ideas in the middle of all of the craziness. And so that was kind of what we wanted to do with the show.
I'm a secret fan. I think nobody knew that I like this kind of stuff, but I love it. I mean, I'm out of the closet now.
There you go.
My mom doesn't let me watch grindhouse stuff, and still doesn't. No, I mean, I think the double feature that came out a while ago with Tarantino and Robert Rodriguez, that stuff was to the max, I think, for me, in one setting. So, yeah, let's go with that.
I like Street Fighter, Sonny Chiba's Street Fighter.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
That is about as good as Grindhouse gets. All right, sir, your question.
Now, first of all, awesome show. I mean, I absolutely love it. My question is, there's a lot of shows that are similar to this in anime style. My one thing I'm thinking of is Boondocks and Afro Samurai. What was like the biggest inspiration of animation-wise for you?
I think those were all kind of touchstones. I don't know that there was anything in particular that we looked at. You know, people have talked about Black Dynamite being another thing, and you know, all of those things, you know, were, I think, kind of in the back of our minds. I thought that with the character of Agent Brister, you know, my influences, you know, were less in the anime space and more in that blaxploitation space. There's a movie called Truck Turner with Isaac Hayes that is, you know, something I watched a lot when we were writing it, simply because it had great dialogue and great scenes and stuff like that. So I think to me, the blaxploitation influence was stronger than some of the shows that you mentioned. But the parallels are certainly there.
Awesome. Chuck Turner also has Nichelle Nichols, who's Uhura Star Trek, as a foul-mouthed madam of a prostitute house.
Yaphet Kotto, it's a good movie.
She slays it, okay.
Hi, so I've never seen this, and this was actually a really good episode or a snippet, and I had to cover her eyes.
Yeah. Good, good.
I did
good,
the same with my kids.
Yeah, this is something I have to watch without her. Yeah. When you mentioned Supernatural, I'm assuming he kind of looks like the Chupacabra. And what other folklore supernatural creatures can we expect from the series?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of that stuff in there. All of the folklore and the legends of Chupacabra, the stories of like the Santa Muerte figure that's in our show is La Santa Lucifera. It's all that sort of iconography. When we were writing the show or prepping for the show, both writers and animators went to like a little botanica shop and worked with a curandero. And there's a curandera character in the show and a bruja character in the show that you'll meet soon. And so, all of that stuff was, also part of the DNA of the show. And so, yeah, there will be some Chupacabra references coming.
Can we expect La Llorona too, or no?
No, exactly, but we have more like La Santa Muerte kind of character. Yeah. I don't want to spoil it. Anything. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do the kids have a question? Go ahead. You can ask your mommy a question.
Oh, really?
Go ahead.
I'm nervous now.
A question from the daughter.
The casting process wasn't.
Also, for the record, we had to cover her eyes.
So. Yes.
Yeah.
But she heard it all.
Okay.
I have a question. So, why did the man needed water, and why did he transform, and what made him transform?
Oh.
That's literally the best question so far.
Sadly, we cannot answer those questions because you have to watch the series, and sadly, you won't, little lady. That's my daughter over there.
Okay, from this side.
So yeah. Cute.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Awesome first episode. It was pretty brutal. I mean it in a really good way. And as I was watching it, I was like, how is this even okay in certain ways? Like, I watch a lot of things, but I'm like, damn. Like, what kind of demographic did you guys have in mind when you guys made it? Or because it's now available on streaming, is it up to the audience to decide what you want to watch and so forth?
I mean, the demographic we had in mind, we weren't sure, you know? I mean, that was the thing. It was a really liberating experience. When we first had our first meeting with Netflix after partnering with Viz and going to Netflix, one of the executives said in that meeting, he said, like, don't try to, like, hit any particular target demographic. Don't say like, oh, we got to put something in here for, 14-year-old boys, or we have to put in something here for people from North Carolina or whatever, don't try to like make something in here for everybody. Just make it as authentic and as specific to the story as you can. Because when people see that, it becomes universal. It becomes like, oh, I could be from, New Zealand and find something in the show because I'm going to say, oh, that must be what that world is like. And so that was kind of a liberating thing. We weren't trying to target any specific demographic other than to say, like what we said earlier, this was about telling stories in the space where we were, in Mexico, dealing with Latino characters, Latina characters. Larry, who is Brister's boss, and I guess Larry's wife, but Larry is basically the only Anglo character in the show, pretty much. So everyone else is Latino, is Latinx, and African American or Chinese and something like that. So that was that was the demographic, I guess, in a way. But it was a demographic in terms of the story, but not in terms of like who we thought the audience would be.
Okay. I'm really happy as an audience that it's not spoon fed to us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Next question over here.
Hi there. I just wanted to ask, what was the funnest part for each of you making the show?
I think for me, it was finding little moments of comedy throughout some of the gore as you go on. Jesus has some moments that I personally laughed out loud at watching it. And so, and they were very like open and free to like have me express myself or change a line or like do it the way Jesus would do it. And it was very collaborative and I really appreciated that. And it was a lot of laughs had in the booth. And what more can you ask for in a job, you know? So, yeah.
The hardest part? The English part. Oh. Only the script that was in English, it was hard for me. No. I was working in Mexico, so I think the hardest part was getting the dates, right? Getting the dates, putting the dates together for me to go back to LA and really be there to be able to do the show. That was the hardest part.
But the funnest part.
Oh, the funnest part. I thought the hardest. I was like, okay, the hardest.
It could be the same.
The funnest part? Oh, my God. The funnest part? Everything. I had a lot of fun. Oh, wait until you see more of this. Because, yeah, this is, I mean, you just saw one of my favorite lines that is Grand Theft Mango. I love that line, but I had so much fun. I cannot tell you because I'm going to spoil the rest of the series, but I think it's episode 5. Ooh, I love it. I had a lot of fun with that one. You'll see why.
Yeah.
Yes, that is amazing. Yeah, everything was so easy for me to just go and I'm telling you again, listen to them and let me go free. Let it go. No, forget it. But yeah, kind of just let myself go and be happy and it was amazing. It was an amazing part. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Sorry, just answer two?
Yeah.
You're allowed. The funnest part for me, you know, I think the funnest part is kind of now. All of this has been amazing, but now the fact that it's out in the world and people are responding to it, whether they love it, whether they hate it, it's like, to me, I'm just excited that people can finally see it and to be able to share it with people, to be able to, you know, just see what the response to this whole thing has been, because it's so... Like I said, my first animated project, something I was never thought I would be able to do, never thought I would be doing. And so it's like this is all somehow really magical to work with great people, the animators, everybody. The music in this movie is insane. It's coming out, and Mondo is doing a vinyl double album of the music from this thing. And it's on CD, and it's on Spotify, and you know, you can find it now, iTunes. It's been an amazing process. So, funnest part right now is getting to be here with you guys.
Okay, it looks like we are just about out of. Oh, sorry. Let's clap for that. That's good. We are out of time, pretty much. So, sorry, no more questions. And for the last thing I'm going to say to you guys is, final pitch. Why would congoers want to check out Seis Manos now that it's streaming on Netflix? You all have 3 seconds to answer.
It'll change your life.
Yeah. Okay.
You will find a hot cup there.
Hot cup.
Wow. Why? Because I think it's the only thing of its kind right now on TV. I mean, I hope that there's more of it. So watch it. We get a season 2.
That's 10 seconds. All right. Give it up for these fine folks. He brought you this amazing anime, Seis Manos. Please
Thank
watch it on Netflix right now.
Thank you guys. So much love.